much for what you're doing for us at the time. I have a question about how do you differentiate yourself between the other candidates when it comes to foreign policy and also primarily President?
The question is on foreign policy, and you know, I know a lot of the pundits are going to write whether it's true or not, and I don't think it is. Going to write, oh, Rick Santorum is, you know, winning because of his social conservatism, which of course you've heard me talk a lot about this morning. That he's going to win because of you know, all of these you know, these rubes in Iowa who just care about babies and guns. The bottom line is, the people in Iowa care about all the issues. They care about babies, and thank God they do. They care about the Second Amendment, and thank God they do, because the Second Amendment is there to protect the First Amendment. And the bottom line is that Iowans, like all Americans, care about having a president who has solid positions on all the issues. And they wouldn't vote for me if I didn't. Right?
Right.
So do you hear that, mainstream media? So, number one. Number two, there's nobody in this race who has the national security experience that I do. I served 8 years on the Armed Services Committee. I was a subcommittee chairman during most of those 8 years. We lost the majority for a brief period of time during my tenure. But I worked on a bipartisan fashion, by the way, in getting things done on that committee before 9/11 to prepare us for the threats that we called at the time asymmetric threats, which we now call terrorism. I was ahead of the curve on that, on Syria, on Iran, which I mentioned before. Passed major national security legislation. Got bipartisan support to do it, to get things that everybody in this room would support. Those are the kinds of things everybody who's from Iowa in this room supports. These are the kinds of things that you're looking for, as a leader who has knowledge, who's been able to see problems. There was an article on the front page of the Washington Post today. The front page of the Washington Post was a story about Iran and their influence in Central and South America. Go and look up The Gathering Storm and Google Rick Santorum and the Gathering Storm, and you will find a series of weekly emails which talked about exactly that for the last 5 years. Exactly what Iran is doing, that now all of a sudden people are saying, oh, gee, look at what's happening. I've been out talking about this and how we have to have a much more proactive policy in Central and South America, or we're going to lose that area of the world. And that's our backyard, and we can't afford it. And two administrations, and I understand why President Bush was otherwise diverted to the Middle East, but he allowed Central and South America in large part to go to seed. Barack Obama has been worse. Barack Obama has deliberately turned our back on our allies in Central and South America and actively embraced those who seek to do us harm, the Venezuelans and the Cubans, and others now in that region because of President Obama's actions in these areas. I use the example of Honduras. Honduras is a small Central American country that has had problems in maintaining stability in their government. And so they were able, and we give great credit to them, able to adopt a constitution that said that we are going to have a one-term president under the constitution. And if, in fact, the president even attempts to change the Constitution so he can run for a second term, that president will be subject to impeachment and being thrown out of office. They were serious about no more dictatorships, like what happened in Venezuela, what happened in Cuba, what's happened in other Central and South American countries in the past. So guess what happened? Well, this new president becomes buddies with Hugo Chavez and Fidel Castro. And Chavez says, well, here's what I did in Venezuela. Here's what we can do to change the Constitution, even though it's unconstitutional to do that. And so this President Zelaya tries to do this. He is discovered. He is tried and impeached. The Supreme Court of the country says it was properly done. He is expelled from the country. Three countries stood up and prominently opposed his ouster. Three. Cuba, Venezuela, and the United States of America. At the very same time, in Iran are pro-democracy folks trying to create a revolution to overthrow the government of Iran. It took Barack Obama one day to condemn Honduras. It took him 2 weeks to even make any kind of coherent statement. When Iran, who has been at war with us since 1979, developing a nuclear weapon, is the manufacturer of the improvised explosive devices that are killing our troops in huge numbers in Afghanistan and previously in Iraq. And this president couldn't muster up any support for the people in the streets who were dying to overthrow that government so they would not be a threat to us and to our friends and allies in the region. This is why this president is the most dangerous commander-in-chief we've seen since Jimmy Carter, and that's why this election is not just about the economy. It is about the security of our country, and we need a leader who understands how to make that security for each and every one of you, as opposed to appeasing the other side.